So today we're going to talk about skill memory, which is covered in chapter 8 of the textbook. And as always, we'll start with behavioral processes, brain substrates, and clinical perspectives. And we'll start by talking about skill memories. So there are a number of different kinds of skill memories. A skill is an ability to perform a task that's been honed through learning. Okay, so it can't be something that's innate. There has to be learning involved. So some of the examples are reading, kissing. Other examples? Audience participation? Riding a bike? Okay. So skill memory is also known as procedural memory. You'll hear that often as a term. And shares some characteristics with declarative memory, which was the topic of the last lecture. So it improves with practice. In both cases, you can get better with time, and they can become long-lasting, potentially permanent. Skill memories are distinct from declarative memories because they're often hard to verbalize. Okay? It's hard to explain to somebody how do you kiss well. Okay? You can be learned and retrieved without conscious awareness. Okay? You're not always very explicitly aware of the skill. It always requires repetition for good learning. It's sort of one of the it's not the sort of thing that you learn on one trial. And as we'll see from some of the brain patient work, it has distinct neural substrates from declarative memory. So here's just a brief overview. Skill memories, this is the current topic, the last week. They're difficult to convey, can be communicated, consciously accessible or not, and require repetitions. So there are a number of different types of procedural memories, some of which we've seen operant responses. We saw that in the lecture on operant or instrumental conditioning. Okay, those were elements of skills, the animals that were trained to do various tasks and peckings or turn around or so forth. Those were all skills. We'll talk here primarily about two types of skills: perceptual motor skills, which are learned movements that are sort of guided by sensory inputs. So there's different ways in which we can move. So learning how to hit a curve ball, how to spike a volleyball. In each case, there's some sensory input, which is the ball and where it is. There are two main classes that are important to understand how to distinguish: closed or open skills. Closed skills are rote sets of movements, which means once you start it, it just continues automatically. It's called closed loop because it doesn't depend on the environmental input. Open skills require adjustment based on the environment, and we'll talk more about that. But the main point is it's a skill, but it involves constantly interacting with sensory input. And finally, we'll talk about habits of problem solving, sort of skills which have to do more. I mean, all skills are invariably expressed with some sort of motor movement. So there's really a fine grade between, you know, even cognitive skills to some degree are expressed in a motor way, but we think of them primarily in terms of the associations or cognitive rules that we've learned. And this just sort of points out that these distinctions are not always sort of clean cut. So let's talk about one of the things that makes skills so interesting is that there are some people who seem to have fabulous skills. Okay, so an expert, we call them an expert. An expert is someone like Garry Kasparov or LeBron James, people who are very, very skilled at some, in this case, a sort of a cognitive ability or a motor ability like sports. Expertise often seems to involve perceptual learning, so that experts, not just that they can do things differently, but they seem to see the world differently. So, for example, chess masters scan the board differently. If you look at a chess master and what they're looking at when they see the board, they're actually just they're looking at it, they're sort of seeing it in the context of strategies that are going on or where it is. There's another famous study that was done that looked at chess masters' ability to recall a board. So if you show somebody, a normal person, a chess board with a number of pieces on it and ask them to, you know, look at it for a few seconds and then replicate what pieces were where, they'll do very poorly. An expert can look at a chess board mid-game and within an instant just sort of have the whole thing perceived and be able to replicate it because they sort of see the pattern. And what's interesting is that the expertise of chess masters only applies if it's looking at a real configuration in the middle of a real game. In other words, something that could actually happen. If you take the same number of chess pieces and randomly put them all over the board, then their ability to recall the board is not much greater than normals. So the point is their expertise only applies because they see it in the context of sort of strategies and the way the game evolves. Okay. Another example shown here is that one of the things that an expert basketball player can do is if they just see somebody setting up for a shot, even before they show, you take a video of someone shooting a shot and you stop it before the ball leaves their hand, experts can predict whether or not it's going to go in. So they can really sort of see that. So So the question for everyone who would like to be an expert is, how do you become an expert? And there's a, just like we've seen in the past, a theme throughout the course of nature versus nurture. People in terms of expertise look at to what extent is it sort of talent, innate talent, that's sort of the nature, or the effort, the practice. And it's clear that, that both play an important role. Not necessarily, not all of us couldn't necessarily become Tiger Woods or a famous gymnast. We may not have the bodies for gymnasts. But just having that innate body doesn't necessarily guarantee that you're going to automatically have it. So it's clear that you have to have an innate predisposition as well as the effort. So in all cases, effort is required. Some of the really sort of world-class experts, whether it's in music or chess or golf, it's often been suggested that it takes about 10,000 hours of practice. So if you think about how many, to reach that sort of world-class level, so you think about how much you really want to be an expert versus 10,000 hours, that's an awful lot of time to devote. Okay. Obviously, those who start off performing a skill well most likely end up becoming experts, but it's also a feedback. If you do something well initially, you get pleasure from it, other people give you positive feedback. You're more likely to devote time and energy to it if you're showing the propensity for it early on. One of the ways in which the issue of nature and nurture has been teased apart in this is by looking at twins, both identical. Okay, so here's a study that shows that pairs of identical twins, okay, so they have 100% of the same genes, and fraternal twins with 50% of the same genes. So this is a standard study that's used. It's called the rotary pursuit, and what it is there's a rotating ring and a stylus, and there's a little thing that moves around, and your job is to sort of track it at various speeds and rotations. That's the kind of skill you can just get better and better at. And what they're looking at is sort of the time on target as this thing is rotating at different speeds and directions. And as you get over many, many trials, you get more and more of the time that you're sort of on the target. You've got the stylus pointing at it. Okay? So that just shows, that's just sort of what this graph looks like when you're, how you're measuring skill in this task. Okay? So everybody who does this will become skilled. And we can use that as a way of looking at the interactions between nature and nurture. So here's the next slide. So what this looks at is the degree of correlation. So it says how similar are people if they're over trial. So if I take two, these are, let's just say, the identical twins, okay? And the higher the correlation, there isn't a y-axis here, the higher the correlation, the more similar they are. And so what we see is that over time, there's not that much change. If anything, maybe it's going up a little bit, okay? As opposed to the fraternal twins, that the more they practice, the less similar they are, okay? So what does that mean? Okay, so participants are identical fraternal with the rotary pursuit. So all participants become skilled. The identical twins were more similar in their performance than fraternal twins. So overall, it says that even though two people with largely the same environment, the identical twins have a greater correlation, even on this, seemingly insignificant task. But that the fraternal twins, the more they practiced, the more you saw this divergence. Okay, so in some sense, because they began overall with less genetic overlap, that the more they practiced and the more there were sort of individual differences in the practice, the more they would diverge. Okay. So relative impacts of talent and effort depend on the context and how it's evaluated. So with the same amount of practice, two pianists who've both taken lessons for 10 years, okay, so imagine that. One gets accepted to Juilliard, that's the major music school, okay? So if they've both practiced for 10 years and one gets in and the other doesn't, you say, well, that's because one really had the innate talent that the other didn't, okay? But with the same talent, you can see the effects of practice. You have two identical twins, one becomes a concert pianist, the other doesn't. In this case, it's probably because one of them, for whatever other reasons, practiced and through effort improved. So the idea is that if one is constant and the other is constant, it's clear there's still variations. So although both talent and practice contribute, it's overall become evident that an awful lot of what makes experts expert is practice, which is why one of the sort of psychological predictors of expertise isn't just your innate expertise at gymnastics or tennis or chess, but your perseverance, your diligence, your willingness to put in those 10,000 hours. Okay. So is there anything you guys would ever imagine wanting to be an expert at? Could you put 10,000 hours into it? How many hours are you putting into neuroscience? Not enough? Okay. Let's talk a bit more about practice. So not all practice is the same. Okay. Practice is usually ineffective without some quality feedback. Okay. So if you keep doing the same thing over and over and over again, you know, you can sit there and drive a golf ball, you know, 1,000, 10,000 times, but if you're not getting any feedback, either in terms of where it lands or in terms of somebody commenting on your skill, then you're not going to get better, which is why either the external feedback, like where the ball lands, or a coach is really critical. Okay. The other thing is too much feedback. You know, you need to be sort of a combination of feedback and then just sort of focusing on what you're doing and practicing it. One of the most pervasive effects from the skill literature is the role of spaced versus massed practice. And one of the things is that you want to space out practice, okay, which means that rather than, you know, if you're going to do 8 hours of practice at something like golf, better to do an hour a day for 8 days than 8 hours all at once. At the same time, practice should consist of a mix of skills rather than focusing on one single skill, which is, this is often called cross-training. So the idea is that if you focus just on one thing over and over and over again, you're like massing what it is you're practicing. And the idea here is you want to be able to spread out. You want to have a distribution over time and a distribution over the actual components of the skills, okay? Because otherwise you tend to sort of get sort of narrowly focused on one component. So let's look at these in turn. So feedback is when you gain knowledge of results during training, and it provides you an indication of how well you're performing the skill. Feedback's essential for most types of learning. So one classic study was Thorndike, asked participants to draw lines exactly 3 inches long while blindfolded. And half the participants were given feedback, told when they were within an eighth of an inch, and half was not. And despite equal amounts of practice, only the feedback group improved. So the idea is that if you're doing something over and over again, unless you're being getting feedback so you can sort of correct yourself, you're not going to get better. So this brings up an issue. What types of feedbacks are given to guide learning in college? Okay. If I gave all of you an A automatically, would that help you? No? Okay. You get feedback when you take the quizzes in the morning. You see automatically how much you actually did retain and understand. Okay. So feedback is really critical. That's why we have all these quizzes, that to make sure people show up. Frequency of feedback is important. So frequent feedback can be helpful initially, but doesn't necessarily lead to high long-term. What you want is sort of infrequent feedback because you need to have people sort of a combination of sort of external feedback and yet internal feedback from sort of monitoring what they're doing and applying it. So you don't want your mother there criticizing you on every step of the way. Maybe occasionally she comes in once a year or twice a year and gives you some tips, okay? So this is the issue of massed versus spaced. Many people, when they're practicing for a performance or a concert, if you do all your practicing the night before, you can learn something really quickly, but it isn't retained well. So the idea of spaced versus mass practice, so spaced practice would be 1 hour a day, mass practice would be 4 hours a day, and what you can then do is equate the total number of hours of practice. And so what you see is that, so this is correct keystroke, so that, I'm not sure what this is. This is some sort of typing task. And what you see is that obviously there's the advantage of doing it 4 hours a day because in terms of days, there's sort of a trade-off. In terms of days, you'll learn faster. But in terms of the actual hours spent, you're less efficient. And so the idea is that here, the fastest, the most learning per hour of practice comes when it's spaced out. Okay, so why do you think that might be? What?
Consolidation.
Maybe it's consolidation. Perhaps it's the effects of sleep being critical. Also the fact that context varies. You know, if you get it all at once, you're all in one day and one time, one place, you're in a particular psychological, mental, biological state. Okay, so what may be happening during that learning is, if it's all massed together, it becomes very context specific. Okay, as you space it out over several days, each day is a different context in terms of the environment, in terms of your own sort of internal state. Okay, so this is often a trade-off because, let's just say you're a company that wants to train an employee. On one hand, you may want to get this employee working on the factory floor as quickly as possible, so you might want to do a lot of mass practice so that in the next few days he can apply it. On the other hand, since their time is valuable and they may be doing other things, you might want to space it out so they're just being trained for 1 hour a day over several days. So it depends on which is more valuable, getting somebody performing within a certain number of days or the actual number of hours that they're devoting. Okay. So overall, space work practice is much better. This also applies to declarative memory. It's one of the reasons why cramming for exams can be ineffective. It may boost you up initially, and maybe it can help you get through an exam, but in terms of long-term retention and understanding, it's very poor. So that's what this is. This is the postal workers keying thing. This is obviously done a long time ago. I don't imagine postal workers do a lot of keying things in necessarily today. But this is sort of practicing. Okay. You guys tend to cram all your studying for the exam at the last minute? Or space it out? Yvonne, what do you think?
It depends.
Okay. Of course, a lot of your studying for exams is more declarative memory, right? But many of the same principles apply in both cases. Let me move this down here. Okay. So constant versus variable. So constant practice is a single skill. Variable practice alternates. And again, the same basic principle of things being distributed. So constant practice would be to play the G major scale 20 times and then move on to the next. Okay, so it's really the same as mass versus bass, but it's mass in terms of what you're actually practicing. Variable is to play a few times, play each of these different scales 5 times. Okay. I had a student in my class who was a competitive pianist, and one of the things that she did is she would go around and borrow other people's pianos and play and practice on them, even though she had her own wonderful piano at home. And the reason is, when you go to a competition, a violin competition, you bring your violin. A piano competition, you have to go and use someone else's piano. And if you've done all your practicing at home on your particular piano, and then you go to the piano at a competition and it's a slightly different model, it can throw you off. So you want to be practicing on lots of different pianos so that your skill becomes generalized and not specific to the piano. So variable practice is often, but not often, more effective. Let me just skip over that here. So we've seen this power law of learning in the past in terms of some of the declarative memory, this idea that things happen very quickly at first and then taper off. So what you see across all species in all sorts of skills is that as you have these days of practice, you see a big increase initially, and then it goes off like this. So by power law means that if you have an exponential scale, this would actually be a line, okay? So it turns out this isn't just sort of tapering out, but at an exponential scale, it's sort of going down. And what that means is that for the first, you know, to get okay at something, there's an enormous amount of satisfaction, because you've gone from knowing nothing to being able to sing a few notes or play a few keys. So there's a huge amount of overall effect early on. But to go from good to great and from great to fabulous requires an incredible amount of effort, and you begin to see the changes. So the point is that although all the people playing in a Masters golf tournament, you know, maybe many, many times better than us, the difference between, you know, someone like Tiger Woods, maybe he's not the best example these days, but and sort of the next person, can often be a huge amount of practice even if the differences in their ability may be so small, but that's where, you know, these championships are won. So the basic idea is deep expertise is so rare, okay, partly because it takes a little practice required to gain reasonable skill. Okay, the more the gains are, the less you'll see. Extreme practice to get the advanced skills, you know, 10,000 hours. And so that to have the time, the energy, and the interest to pursue something to that highest level is very, very rare. That's why the sort of the psychological perseverance or diligence or desire is really key. And lots of people, you know, will lose interest once they get down to about here. Okay. So one of the ways in which the power law of learning, we talked about the importance of feedback as you're learning a skill, skill memory. Feedback can essentially kickstart the next level of sort of improvement. So here you're learning, participants are learning to kick a target rapidly. You know, they get better and better and better in this sort of power law. And then at this point they're shown a film that gives them feedback. And you see another sort of scallop coming in. So it's the idea is that you can keep getting these power laws, you know, from the sort of, this is why I was talking about the infrequent feedback, that you need to give someone some feedback. They then sort of practice it. And of course you're getting feedback, you know, if you're playing, if you're golfing, you're seeing if the ball goes in. If you're kicking, you're seeing whether or not, you know, you actually kick it and how fast it is. So you do get feedback from the actual execution. It's not that it's the absence of feedback, but additional feedback in terms of someone else giving you specific technique advice, you know, or showing you a film of you can sort of start you over again like that. Okay. Many skills are thought of as being a form of implicit learning. That means they can be learned without conscious effort. So explicit learning is learned with conscious effort. You're studying for an exam. You're consciously aware of that. Implicit learning is without conscious effort. Okay. So for example, if you've learned the words to some popular song but you didn't know it, you know, because it was just sort of playing through your head unconsciously, or you're listening to it unconsciously. If you can remember the logo for some of the stores, like Target or Gap, okay, you may not have been seeing them. You know, when I ask you, you know, what is the typeface or logo look like for these stores, you may know them not because you were ever expected to be tested on it, but just you've seen them enough and you sort of implicitly learn them. Okay. So one of the ways in which this kind of implicit learning and unconscious learning is studied in the lab is through a task where what happens is you see a target and you press a corresponding button. So it's very simple. There are, say, five, let's say they've got four, there are four different lights and four different buttons, and when each light goes on, one, two, three, four, you press the corresponding button. So there's not really much of a skill. You know, you're told the instructions and anyone can follow it. And it just these lights come on in various sequences and you have to press the button. So what happens is, so that's just a fairly standard skill. You might imagine that, you know, you get a little bit better at it for a while and then you would just sort of asymptote. What happens though is that embedded in this otherwise random sequence are particular patterns that are repeated over and over again, okay? And what happens is when those patterns come up, and people aren't often aware of it, you know, they may be completely unaware that within this so-called random sequence, there's a particular pattern of 10 that gets repeated over and over. And yet if you look at their reaction times, what you see is that, you know, they're on the random trials, you know, they're taking 500 milliseconds, but on the sequential trials, the ones that are part of this embedded pattern, they're going much faster. So even though they're not consciously aware that there's a repeated sequence, at some subconscious level, they're able to they recognize it, and they're able to take advantage of it by anticipating where the next light will be. Okay, so we'll turn now to talking about the brain substrates of skill memory and focus first on the basal ganglia. So declarative memories, which we talked about last time, the semantic and episodic, they're flexible, they're consciously accessible, they're verbalizable, they depend on consolidation in the medial temporal lobe, especially the hippocampus. And we know that these patients who have damage to the hippocampus, the medial temporal lobe, can no longer form new declarative memories, but they can learn new skills. So the question is, what are the brain regions not damaged in HM? The procedural skill memories are often sort of, as we've talked about, rigid. They depend on several structures, the basal ganglia, the cerebellum, and some regions of cortex. And we'll talk about all three of these. And one of the kinds of patients that, is this right here, one second? Let me see something here. One of the kinds of patients that we have, I don't know why this review is here, that we will talk about in particular are patients with basal ganglia damage. Why is this, there's something wrong here, one second. So let's talk a bit about the basal ganglia. So this is, shows the basal ganglia here. You see the cerebral cortex. These are the basal ganglia, the cerebellum, the brainstem, and the spinal cord. And the basal ganglia collects information from throughout the cortex. It outputs to the thalamus, and from there through the motor cortex. Among many things it does is it regulates the velocity, direction, and amplitude of movement. So it's not surprising that a lot of the skilled motor tasks, and as we found out also cognitive tasks, depend on the basal ganglia. They're particularly important for forming new skill memories. Damage impairs the creation of procedural memories, but not declarative memory. So the people who have damage to the striatum are dissociated from damage to the hippocampus. Recordings that we'll talk about show that skill training produces task-relevant coding of neural activity in the basal ganglia. And imaging studies show an increased activity that reflects the learning of skills. So let's look at each of these in turn. So classic studies, two modes. There are two ways you can learn a radial arm maze. There's one which is like declarative memory. So half the arms have food, but no markings. And rats must sequentially search through the arms and remember where the rats are, okay? Okay, where the food is. All right, and they do it with no clues other than just the spatial location. In procedural learning, half the arms are lit, okay? They're illuminated and have food, and the animal just has to learn the rule that light predicts food, okay? And so the idea is that this is a hippocampal dependent, this is a basal ganglia dependent. And if you, these are some of the graphs, if you do a hippocampal lesion, this is a graph from the book and it's actually really poor, I'm just noticing it now, it's sort of a poor choice of graphs because in one case high is good and the other case high is bad. You know, high is bad is errors, high is good. So it looks like hippocampal lesions are having the same effect on these two. But in fact, it's the opposite, okay? Anyway, I'm just noticing that this is a very confusing graph because it's comparing two things, but it's using different axes so that although these things look identical, in fact, they're very different. So here, a basal ganglia lesion is causing a big deficit, and here a hippocampal lesion is causing a big deficit, but it's expressed in high errors. So I'm just pointing out the very poor human factors that I want to. Basal ganglia damage impairs skill learning, that's sort of learning of the habits. In contrast, damage to the medial temporal lobe impairs declarative memory and impairs the spatial learning. So this is one of the ways in which you get these dissociations between learning based on sort of declarative or spatiotemporal context navigation versus striatal habit learning by being able to selectively do lesions. One of the other ways we can see this is in studies done with rats looking at recording, okay? And so you see changes throughout training in a rat. So this is a rat that's learning. It comes down a T-maze, it gets a tone, and the tone will basically tell it, depending on what the tone is, to turn left or to turn right, okay? So early on in training, most activity occurs during the turn, okay? The animal is, Muhammad, could you take that out of the wrapper so it's not keeps clean every time. So the idea is that the basal ganglia initially, before there's learning, is just responding to the movement, turn left or turn right. But later in training, all the neurons become task relevant. They basically start to fire at the beginning and they start to fire at the end, suggesting that what the basal ganglia has done is it's gone from just sort of responding to sort of the random turn left and turn right to sort of beginning a whole sequence that it's sort of stored. So the idea is that it's the basal ganglia are sort of taking over from being the sort of rote responding to the turn to picking up the fact that they're about to set into motion a particular habit, a particular rule. This is a study that I did with Russ Poldrack. This is the weather prediction task that we see here, a nice graph. And participants are learning this probabilistic classification, learning to predict the weather with each card only partially associated with weather conditions, And as learning progresses, activity in the basal ganglia increased, much like the increased activity in the rats in the Q maze, and the better people got, the more basal ganglia activity you had. So another way of seeing it. The basal ganglia seems to be particularly important for forming new skill memories. Damage impairs the creation of procedural memories, but not declarative memories. And recordings show that skill training produces task-relevant coding. So this is the idea is that as the rats are learning the T maze, they go from sort of just basal ganglia activity when they're responding sort of motorically to sort of picking up the cues that begin the maze, the tones and so on and so forth. Okay? Nevertheless, there's still a lot of uncertainty about the precise role of the basal ganglia. It's involved in movement, so lesions' effects on skill learning could also be movement problems, and so it's often important to try to dissociate a movement deficit from a learning deficit. Just like we talked before about how there was a controversy over whether the hippocampus is always necessary for movement, always necessary for memory, or whether eventually the memories get completely independent of the hippocampus. There are similar issues here, whether or not the basal ganglia are important just for learning and storage of new skills, and then once a skill becomes automatized, whether or not you still need it. Did anybody ever see the movie Awakenings about the early use of actually of L-DOPA in patients with this chronic encephalitis? What was the disease they had? They had some sort of what was the actual disease that they had in the movie? It's something from the flu. They had developed something like a severe form of Parkinson's that left them sort of rigid and locked in as a result of a flu. And so they were essentially locked in, frozen for many years. They gave these people and they were able to reproduce them. But there's a great scene in the movie where there's this woman who's sort of frozen in her chair and she can't move. And she has, we believe now, sort of very severe basal ganglia damage. And Oliver Sacks throws a baseball, a tennis ball at her, and she reaches, and it comes again at her, and she reaches up and she grabs it, or knocks it away. And everyone is shocked because they've never seen her make any kind of movement. And the idea is that those sort of automatic defensive movements are initiated in response to something external, as opposed to her, but her real problem was sort of initiating movements. So the basal ganglia seems to be particularly involved in initiating movements and learning new movements. People, Parkinson's patients, can often at a certain point play tennis. Now, who is it who said they're a tennis player here? But they often lose the ability to serve. So the idea is that they can't initiate a movement when it sort of has to be internally guided to say, okay, now I move it. On the other hand, if somebody else serves and the ball comes at them, they can respond appropriately. So it's not just initiating a movement, it's not just sort of making the movement, but it's a self-initiated movement that seems particular. So it's like choosing what to do. Okay. In non-mammals, the cerebral cortex is probably unrelated to skill learning because most non-mammals don't have much of a cerebral cortex or any, and they can obviously still learn skills. It's not something that can be sort of studied in lower animals below mammals, but in mammals, reorganization of the cortex seems to play an important role. So training expands. We saw before, you've seen other courses, these homuncular regions or whole regions of somatosensory cortex and sensory cortex that respond to the body. Training expands the cortical space that are relevant to a skill. And this is often accompanied by actual increased volume in that area. And disuse will shrink it. For example, when someone is being trained, a bass player, okay, you know, who just grasps with one hand the bow, and the other is doing very complex fingering, and they're doing this for the requisite 10,000 hours to become a symphony player. In their brain, the representation of the fingers for the left hand will become much larger than the fingers for the right hand, because the right hand is just kind of gripping it and going like this, and the left hand is doing all the work. All right, and there are some classic studies by Mike Mersnick. Where you actually sort of would sew together two fingers of a monkey, and you'd find that the representation of those finger fields shrink and get you know, so eventually you just have the same amount of cortical neurons devoted to the two fingers as one. If you remove a finger, what happens is that the area of cortex that used to encode that finger gets adopted by the other, so you actually get greater sensitivity nearby. So let's look at these. Skill practice expands the amount of cortical space dedicated to representing skill-related sensations and movements. So we're talking about sensory cortex and motor cortex. I described the violinists. Racquetball players probably have an expanded in their dominant hand. And monkeys that learn to turn a key with their forearm, you can actually see the expanded representation in primates and so forth. So all over you can see, primarily in animal studies, but also in sort of human imaging, just a growth of brain regions, as if there's this ongoing competition. In juggling, where people are being trained to juggle, within just 7 days of training, the visual gray matter was increased, okay? With 3 months of training, you can see a 3% increase in the visual cortex. So the idea is that you can not only see activity changes and in animals and in humans, but you actually see volume changes. So clearly suggesting new neurons or new synapses are growing. Another brain region is the cerebellum, the little brain. You can see it sort of in these various structures here. It's important for skill learning, but at a different time scale. It's very involved. It's a very ancient form, and you see it in all vertebrates. It takes inputs from the spinal cord, the sensory systems, and the cortex. We saw it before when we were discussing what kind of learning earlier in the course. When did we talk about the cerebellum? What kind of learning did we talk about earlier in which the cerebellum played a key role? I'll give you a hint. Instrumental conditioning or classical conditioning? Okay, well, that's 50% right. Now, what particular classical conditioning paradigm depends on the cerebellum? Okay, the rabbit eye blink, the eye blink conditioning that we talked about. Okay, that critically depends on the cerebellum. It's an example of a sensory motor response, a well-timed motor response, or anything that involves, so here, by the way, it was on the screen all the time, you guys missed it. Anything that involves particularly fine timing, playing the piano, you know, rapid sequencing, like a blink within 500 milliseconds, all that learning tends to be cerebellar. It also can be used for mirror tracing. This is an example where you're sort of learning this motor movement, to sort of the skill to sort of trace a design in a mirror without seeing your hand. So all you're getting is the feedback, but it's reversed in the mirror. And what you see is people with cerebellar lesions are very impaired at learning. I mean, they are, obviously they don't have complete cerebellar lesions, they probably are partial lesions, but overall they learn much slower. Cerebellum seems to be particularly important for anything that involves timing. Okay, that includes language and all this fine motor. And for various reasons, I'm not going to go through the slide in detail. You can read it in the textbook. There seems to be some lateral effects. I mean, obviously there's the laterality that comes from the left cerebellum controlling the right hand and vice versa. But also even in skills like reading, where the cerebellum is involved. There seems to be laterality because of the laterality in language. So let me just briefly summarize. There are three different brain regions strongly implicated in skill learning: the basal ganglia, the cerebral cortex, and the cerebellum. The basal ganglia lesions selectively impair skill learning, and the physiology shows development for task-related firing, so electrophysiology, and these are probably important for both cognitive and motor skills. Skill learning reorganizes the cerebral cortex, for those of us who are higher mammals and have cerebral cortex, expanding gray matter volume, expanding receptive fields are changing as we're developing expertise. And the cerebellum is critically involved in learning and performing motor sequences like eye blink conditioning or piano. Okay, the cerebellum is also critical for doing this. Or is everybody, close your eyes. Okay, now close your eyes. Now touch your finger to your nose. Okay, good news is that nobody seems to have had two beers beforehand. If you've ever been stopped for drunken driving, that's one of the tasks which the police will often ask you to do, that and sort of walking a line. And the reason is that the cerebellum is particularly sensitive to alcohol levels in the blood. That's why people get often clumsy and can't get their key into the house or their key into the car, because the cerebellum is disrupted. So closing your eyes and touching your finger to your nose is a quick test of cerebellar function that's often used as a test for drunk driving. So we're going to wrap up and just talk about three clinical disorders. So apraxia is poor coordination of purposeful skilled movements. It most commonly comes from head trauma or stroke. I'm not sure how much you can see here, a lesion from somebody with apraxia. It's involved cortical damage. You can have selective apraxias. Left damage can be involved in imitating actions. Frontal damage, you can't pantomime actions with two hands, which means you can't like do one thing and the other. So where things are in the cortex can damage very selectively certain types of skilled movements. Skill memory can also be impaired. Okay, you can also have difficulty recognizing performance, because part of our recognition of skills is our ability to sort of process it and imitate it internally. There have been new approaches to use transcranial magnetic stimulation. Is anyone doing that here at the center? Is April doing some TMS? No. And basically, TMS is a painless current is induced into the brain. Depending on the stimulation and where it is, one can actually boost the cortex or disable it. Muhammad, do you know why it can sometimes boost it or disable it? Why is TMS sometimes activate a region and sometimes inactivate it?
Well, it depends on what neurons are activated. So it depends on what neurotransmitter is being put in there.
In other brain regions, that's right. Okay. So some people have been, one of the reasons this has been used is you can sort of create selective apraxias. This is like creating a temporary stroke. Not that I want to do it, but, okay. Huntington's disease, it's an inherited disease. It causes damage to both the basal ganglia and the cerebral cortex. It causes very severe motor disorders. It used to be called Huntington's chorea, and the chorea referred to sort of the dance, because Huntington's patients would seem to be dancing all the time. And that's because in the basal ganglia and the cortical loops, they can initiate movements, but they can't stop them. So if you think about a Parkinson's patient being frozen, they can't initiate a movement. People with Huntington's disease have almost the opposite problem with their basal ganglia. They can initiate but not stop. And if you ever see patients with Parkinson's who are over-medicated, they often develop something that looks a bit like Huntington's, where they have these uncontrollable movements. Have you ever seen Michael J. Fox being interviewed, where he's kind of going like this? That's actually not the disease, but it is sort of the response to the medication. So it has also a lot of mood disorders, psychological problems, sexual problems, motor debilities. There's a lot of facial twitching and progressive shaking. I think it's the shaking, which was called the chorea. They can learn new skills slowly, but difficulty with a lot of the tasks we've talked about. Barbara Knowlton, who is one of my collaborators, took some of our tasks and did the weather prediction in Huntington's. So this was actually a study using our weather prediction task, where patients with Huntington's sort of never learn, controls can learn it quite well. We tried to do some work with Huntington's. They're just so much more impaired than Parkinson's. It's very hard to do work. We actually had a Huntington study going at North Shore with people who don't have Huntington's but have the genes, and somehow that never quite got to fruition to publish. Parkinson's disease, a big area here at the center, Jim Tepper's lab, Elizabeth's lab, my lab. One of the newer treatments is deep brain stimulation, where an electrode will go down to the thalamus and it will effectively cause a lesion. You know, you can essentially turns on an electrical but transient lesion to areas that are impaired. So just briefly to summarize, three areas where skill learning are impaired. Apraxia is cortical region damage from head injury or stroke. Difficulty producing purposeful movements. Damage interferes with the control and execution. And TMS is one way to transiently and temporarily induce it and simulate it. Huntington's is an inherited disorder. It's gradual damage throughout the brain, especially both the basal ganglia and the cerebral cortex. Many deficits in perceptual motor skill learning, and is beginning to identify some of the genetic markers. And finally, Parkinson's involves disruption in the basal ganglia and progressive deterioration of motor control. Patients show increasing degrees of muscle tremor and rigidity. And deep brain stimulation to the basal ganglia cortical loop is one of the ways in which it's treated.